گلن دیویس نماینده آمریکا در آژانس بین‌المللی انرژی اتمی است. نماینده کشوری که رهبران جمهوری اسلامی ایران معتقدند عزمش را جزم کرده که نگذارد ایران در صنایع اتمی پیشرفت کند. و اگرچه 9 کشور عضو دائم و غیر دائم شورای امنیت سازمان ملل به قطعنامه تنبیهی اخیر علیه ایران رای دادند، ولی از نظر رهبران ایران این آمریکاست که پشت سر همه این دشمنی‌ها با ایران است. جواب نماینده آمریکا در آژانس به این اتهام‌ها چیست؟ Ambassador Glenn Davis, welcome to Bharat Diya.
Thank you very much.
I have only been in Vienna since last summer, but felt like a lifetime due to the alarming evolution in Iran's nuclear activity and IAEA's concern. That's your word a few months ago.
Yes, yes.
How does it feel now?
Yes. Well, it's been very, it's been interesting, to use a neutral word, for the last 11 months, 12 months. I've been in Vienna trying to do everything possible to find a way to create a diplomatic opening to try to resolve the Iranian nuclear problem. And it hasn't been easy, because ever since last fall, when the first efforts were made to reach out to Iran, to talk to them in Geneva and in Vienna, we have had a series of challenges and, frankly, setbacks from Iran, and it does not appear as if Iran has had a real interest in trying to find a solution, and that has been a big disappointment.
But now President Ahmadinejad saying that we are willing to go back to the negotiating table with no conditions. Before that, the Iranian foreign minister said the same thing, and also official from the Iranian nuclear energy organizations.
Yes.
How optimistic are you that this time they are coming back?
Yes.
And if there is any negotiation,
yes.
Well, fruits?
I'm a diplomat, so I'm paid to be optimistic, and I'm very optimistic that we can perhaps find a way forward. But because of the frustrations of the last 11 months, all of our attempts, not just the United States, but all of the permanent five members of the Security Council, Germany, the EU, and others, to try to find ways to reach out to Iran and to get them to talk about the concerns that the international community has about their nuclear program. Every time we've tried that, to engage with them, to give them incentives, we have found ourselves blocked, really. And that has been tremendously frustrating. So I remain optimistic about it. The door is still open. We hope we can find a way forward on the Iranian nuclear problem. But we have had to now combine incentives and engagement with pressure. And that was the purpose in the Security Council of passing the sanctions, to focus the Iranians on the need to take this seriously. We're very serious about trying to find a way forward. What the Middle East does not need is a country that is moving at 100 kilometers an hour toward a nuclear weapons capability. That is not good for the whole region.
Well, you talked about the pressure. Well, indeed, the United States of America probably has been more vociferous and active for putting that pressure on Iran. Now, you have your sanctions. And do you think that the fact that the President Ahmadinejad and others in Iran are saying that you want to go back to the negotiating table is because of that sanction?
It's hard to say. One of the things that I have learned in the last year in Vienna is not to try to fully understand or predict the reasons why Iran makes decisions and makes pronouncements. All I know is that we should continue along this path of trying to find ways to engage Iran, but at the same time, showing Iran that it can't continue to defy the will of the international community. It can't continue to ignore the responsibilities that Iran has as a member of the IAEA and a signer of the Non-Proliferation Treaty. It must, at some point, address these concerns that the world community has. so that we can find a peaceful way forward here. Unfortunately, over the last 11 or 12 months, we've seen the opposite from Iran.
What is it exactly that you want from Iran? What do you want Iran to do?
Well, we would like Iran to pay attention to the will of the international community as expressed in a series of United Nations Security Council resolutions, no fewer than 10 resolutions of the IAEA. They should pay attention to this. These are serious expressions of concern. They should cease their provocative activity. They should.
Which is what?
Well, for instance, building additional nuclear facilities in secret, enriching uranium material close to highly enriched uranium.
But Ambassador, these are part of the things that the IAEA has actually permitted Iran and many other countries to do. They say that they were actually sticking to the rules and regulations of IAEA.
The IAEA's role is not to permit or deny. The IAEA's role is to the extent possible, to through its board of governors, to make judgments about whether or not countries are in compliance with their obligations. And the last time that the 35-nation Board of Governors of the IAEA had a vote about Iran's nuclear behavior, only three countries voted against a resolution that was condemning Iran for its failure to cooperate. There were eight countries that abstained, including countries like Egypt, but the vast majority of countries voted to condemn Iran. And this was the 10th time in many years that the Board of Governors has pronounced itself. So we think Iran should take seriously the concerns that the world has about the direction in which Iran is going on its nuclear
program. The argument by the Iranians is that we actually adhere to every rules and regulation of the IAEA. We joined the additional protocol, and we were promised by the Western country to be helped on the nuclear industry in Iran. But we fulfilled our obligations. The West didn't.
Yes.
Why should we do it now?
Iran takes a very strict view of its obligations. Yes, it signed the additional protocol, but then it later denounced it and renounced it. So now Iran says we don't follow the additional protocol.
So they denounced it when they actually said that the Western country didn't fulfill their obligations.
Oh, that's...
They put pressure instead of actually appeasing
it. That's not the case at all. They renounced the additional protocol when they believed that the IAEA was getting a little too close to the truth about the nature of their nuclear program. I mean, I think that's why they announced the additional protocol. And so when it came to light that they were building a secret facility near the holy city of Qom, for instance, they said, well, we've fulfilled our obligations because we renounced our adherence to the additional protocol. We didn't have to tell the world community that we were doing this. But from the standpoint of all of the nations of the world that are concerned about developments in the Middle East, this was very alarming that they would do this. It was alarming that they are enriching to 20% uranium. It was alarming that they kicked two inspectors out of Iran for doing their jobs. It's alarming that they're not answering the questions that are being put to them by the IAEA and its inspectors about the military aspects of their program. All of these things accumulated.
But despite all that, Ambassador, sorry to interrupt you, but despite all that, the IAEA's reports have always been inconclusive. They never said and presented any hard evidence, nor the American presented any hard evidence to say that the Iranians are up to no good.
Yeah, I would dispute that. I think if you read the reports of the IAEA very closely, including from the era before December of last year when Mohammed El-Baradei was Director General of the IAEA, you see a pattern on the part of Iran of always, always, always pushing the limits of preventing the IAEA from getting the answers that it asks for. In fact, the way Mohammed El-Baradei put it at the very end of his tenure in office was, he said, Iran is on the wrong side of the law. That was Mohammed El-Baradei. And we still get from the IAEA very, very worrisome reports about the activities that are going on in Iran. So it is not correct
to say. That is correct, Ambassador. But what I'm saying is they never said that Iran is up to building nuclear weapon, for example.
What they have
said that.
What they have said is they don't have sufficient answers from Iran or evidence from Iran to assure themselves that Iran is not pursuing weapons technology.
And that, do you think that merits sanctions?
I think that merits sanctions because I think this is a region of the world that is exceedingly important to the peace and stability of not just that hemisphere, but the whole globe. We need to ensure that that we don't end up with an arms race in the Middle East. We need to ensure that we don't have situations where countries feel so threatened by the rhetoric or the actions of others that they attack them. We have to avoid that at all costs. I'm a diplomat. I believe that's the answer to this problem. And the way to do that with Iran is for Iran to take seriously these concerns, to allow the IAEA to do its job, to stop this enrichment that the Security Council has called on them to stop. They need to do these things. Instead, they're moving in the other direction. They're the only one of 189 nations that belong to the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty that is not fulfilling its obligations. The only one.
Yeah, but the counter-argument is that you talk about rights and responsibilities. What about the rights and responsibilities of Israel?
Well, Israel is not a signatory of the Non-Proliferation Treaty.
Exactly.
We think they should be.
Yeah.
That has been our policy for many years.
But what sort of pressure are you putting on Israel?
And here is the answer to that. Mm-hmm. In 1995, when all of the countries who had signed the NPT came together, they passed a resolution saying we should move toward a weapons of mass destruction free zone, a nuclear free zone in the Middle East. For 15 years, nothing happened on that. You can blame a lot of people for why that happened. But now, in May of 2010, in New York, was a resolution approved by consensus of the organization saying, let's try to create conditions for a conference in 2012 to move the region toward a weapons of mass destruction free zone. The only way that's
but
going
Israel
to happen.
But Israel is refusing.
The
it's
only
still
way.
Refusing.
Well,
so what I'm saying, Ambassador, what sort of pressure is United States of America is putting on Israel to actually to join
yes,
the
NPT? Yes, but you see, I think you and many others are phrasing the question improperly. What has to happen is all of the countries of the region, Iran, Israel, all countries in between, they have to have incentive to do this. How can you achieve a weapons-free zone in the Middle East unless the region is at peace? That's the most important thing. So in parallel with efforts to try to achieve a weapons of mass destruction-free zone, you need to move down the path of peace. You're never going to eliminate these threats, these weapons, unless the region can be at peace. You have Iran saying to Israel, saying about Israel, they call it the Zionist entity, that they will wipe it from the face of the earth. That's not a condition in which you can achieve an elimination of these weapons. You need to create conditions so that Israel will want to come in 2012 to a conference. And it doesn't work if what you get from the NPT review conference and what you get from the IAEA General Conference in September are resolutions that single out Israel and that condemn Israel. You shouldn't, that can't be the way to proceed.
Okay. No, the Western countries have the sanctions against Iran. How optimistic are you that this sanction is going to work?
Sure.
Results, the kind of result that
Well, remember, it's not just the Western countries. It's also China, it's Russia. I mean, it's the whole, it's all.
I mean, you can agree that they come reluctantly. I mean, they needed lots of persuasion to join it.
I think with China and with Russia, there is a much broader area of agreement than there is disagreement. I think they recognize, I can't speak for them, I'm not Chinese, I'm not Russian, but they were part of this process, they voted for this resolution, and they did it because they have a concern about the direction of events in Iran, as did all but two members of the United Nations Security Council. And so in vote after vote after vote, year after year after year, not just in the UN Security Council, but in the 35-nation Board of Governors, there is expression after expression, resolution after resolution, expressing concern about and calling on Iran to do what it should do, what it has said it will promise to do, which is develop a peaceful nuclear program.
Well, do you think the sanctions are going to work?
I think sanctions are necessary, and I think sanctions can work, and I think there has been some sign that sanctions have begun to work. I think they are getting the attention of Iranian leaders. I think they make it more difficult for Iran to develop its missile technology and its nuclear technology. It's affecting their banks, their transport, their insurance, the Revolutionary Guards Corps. I think I wish we didn't have to do sanctions, but I don't know any other way to get a country that for year after year after year ignores its requirements to focus on them and to do the right thing.
But there are always individuals and countries who are willing to find a way around these sanctions and deal with Iran and break
the sanctions. They will try. I mean, countries may try to do that, but I think over time, if you're sitting in Tehran, this becomes more and more difficult to pursue the kinds of goals that they seem to be interested in, which is developing these technologies, giving themselves the capability at some point to perhaps develop a nuclear weapon. And so, sadly, this is what we are brought to do after over a year, almost a year and a half, of trying to provide incentives, of trying to engage Iran in the P5 plus one process in Geneva, in the Vienna, between the Vienna group, Russia, France, the United States, and Iran. We've been trying repeatedly to engage them. And every time, Iran's answer is, oh, well, we can't do that, or oh, we don't trust you, or oh, this is our right, or oh, we are fulfilling our obligation.
They are saying that you want to come back to the negotiating table. Let's say that they come back and they agree to the agreement reached by Mr. Al-Baradei last year with Iran. And on the exchange of uranium and all that.
Yes.
Let's say they agree to that.
Yes.
What would be the next step by the?
Yeah, that would be great if and if they would answer the questions.
So what would you do after?
Because the Vienna group of Russia, France, the United States has put questions to Iran through Mr. Amano, and we've asked for clarification of what it was that came out of the Tehran declaration that had some very good work done by Brazil and Turkey. Their hearts are in the right place. They're trying to find a way to make this work. We respect that. What we haven't gotten from Iran is any beginning of an answer to any of these nine or so questions that we've raised. All they have said is, we're willing to come back and talk to you without preconditions. And remember, that's not as important as the broader process led by Catherine Ashton of the EU, the so-called P5 plus one process. That's the real process that needs to be nourished, needs to be successful. And since October 1st in Geneva of last year, Iran has time after time refused to come back and talk to that group about these concerns.
So this time, if they come, I mean, it's slightly hypothetical, but nevertheless,
it would be great if they came.
Since they have expressed their willingness to come back to the negotiating table, if they come and agree to all that, what I'm saying is, what I'm asking basically is, what would be the next step by the Western country? Are they going to cancel all the sanctions and everything?
Well, what we need to do, what we've learned in dealing with Iran is that you need to have a combination of incentives and enticements, if you will, but also pressure. We've learned that the only way to get Iran to take seriously these concerns that are being raised by the international community is through a degree of pressure. And we've tried to make that as targeted as possible. We've tried, all of us involved in designing these sanctions, to keep them away from affecting the Iranian people to the extent possible. No one wants to hurt the innocent in Iran. So they're directed at those few individuals who are the decision makers, the IRGC, the Revolutionary Guards, banking, transport, the missiles, the nuclear field. That's what they're directed at. And the hope is that Iran's leaders will get the message that we're serious about trying to find a peaceful, diplomatic way forward, avoid conflict, avoid attacks. Let's put the history behind us. Let's move forward. Let's make this work. That's why the door is still open for engagement with Iran. And we hope, finally, Iran will walk through that door and begin to take seriously the concerns that we all have about their nuclear program.
But Iranians are saying that the Iranian enrichment has always been for peaceful purposes, for civilian purposes. And they are saying that at the moment there are something like 800 50,000 cancer sufferers in Iran who, as a result of the Western action and preventing Iran of enriching to their 20% uranium, they're going to suffer because they cannot have the radioisotope that they need.
When Iran came to the IAEA and it said, our reactor is about to run out of fuel, we need fuel for these cancer patients, the United States and Russia and France went to the IAEA and said, we would like to talk to Iran about this, because we saw it as a chance. It was a chance not only to help cancer sufferers, patients in Iran, but from a diplomatic standpoint, a chance to begin to create a diplomatic opening with Iran, to begin to have a real, serious, honest conversation about their nuclear program, to give them an opportunity to demonstrate that their program is peaceful. When Mohammed al-Baradei said to us in the third week of October of last year, you have 72 hours, you write me a letter and you tell me whether you agree with this, the United States, I signed the letter myself, Russia, their ambassador, France, their ambassador, we all signed letters to Mohammed al-Baradei. We said, we agree with this proposal. Nothing from Iran until May, which is 7 months later, when they began to try to change the terms of the deal and when they involved Turkey and Brazil, who have been, who have played, I think, a positive role in this overall, who mean seriously to find a solution to this. And now, when you say that they want to come back with no preconditions, that's not exactly true, because the Iranians have, we've heard from Ahmadinejad, lots of conditions. We need to hear their view of the Israeli program. We need to have them swear that they will, that their intentions towards us are good.
At least they were saying the preconditions to coming back to the negotiating table. They may discuss all that topics that you mentioned on that negotiating process.
But they should worry, they should worry about 850,000 cancer patients. I agree, that's important. We should find a way to help them keep that reactor going so that they can get those isotopes for the patients. We're not trying to hold any patients hostage. What we're trying to do is find a way to help Iran solve this humanitarian problem, number one. Number two, to find a diplomatic opening to resolve the Iranian nuclear problem.
Okay. No, you have the sanction in place. Do you have any deadline by which you reckon that this sanction is going to work?
No, I don't think anybody is laying
out how much more time are you giving to
You're asking me to predict the future. If I could do that, I would be a stockbroker
or investor.
I wouldn't be a diplomat. No, I mean, we're staying focused on the same policy that Barack Obama laid out when he became president of the United States, which is we will engage Iran, but at the same time, if engagement does not prove to be successful, we will have to find ways to bring pressure on Iran. And that is a phase that we're in right now. But it doesn't mean that engagement goes away. It doesn't. Okay. We want to remain
engaged. Let me put it a different way, this question. Yeah. What if the sanction didn't work? What next?
Well, that's a theoretical question.
What if it's not. I mean, you put the sanction in place and it may not work.
I think the sanctions are working, and I think they will work. And I'm an optimist, and I think they will focus the thinking of the leaders in Tehran on the need to discuss these issues seriously with everybody. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time worried about, well, if the sanctions don't work, what happens then? Because what happens then, frankly, is a bit unthinkable, because nobody wants
There are already some mention of actions, military actions. For example, the former CIA Director General said that there is a possibility, it could be even inevitable, because Iran is just going ahead with this program. The U.S. Chief of Staff saying that we have everything in place for military action.
Yes.
So what's your plan?
Well, what we're ready to do is whatever we need to do. But we want what we want to do, and what we're directing our efforts at is in fact a diplomatic solution to this. That's where we are right now. So engagement, still there very much, but pressure is also part of this. And we hope that not just the United States, but that all other countries of the world who care about the future of the Middle East, who care about the integrity of the non-proliferation treaty, that all voices come together to try to find a way to solve this problem. And I think that's the way it'll work. It'll only work if the world community comes together. People can't say, America, fix it. Everybody listens to you, and you're the most powerful country, and you've got to be the ones to dictate solutions. Those days are over. The only way we solve global problems or regional problems is if all the countries of the globe, all the countries of various regions, come together and find ways to do it peacefully. I'm a diplomat. That's the way I think we need to proceed.
Ambassador, do you have any kind of friendly encounter with your counterpart, Iranian counterpart in Vienna?
Do you talk
to each other? Do you have a coffee together?
We don't have coffee together. But no, I shake his hand. He is there at the IAEA. In the context of the IAEA, we are both colleagues of a sort. But no, I don't negotiate directly with him. We did to the extent that when Mohammad Abaradei chaired the talks back in October, the Iranian side was there, the Russians, the French, the United States, the IAEA team. So we had talks in that context. But, I greet him because he is, is a diplomatic colleague, but I don't engage in discussions with him or talks with him.
Ambassador Glenn Davis, thank you very much for being the guest of Be'er Barat Diyar.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Enjoyable. Thanks so much.